Hello friends, welcome to video series on geography. In this video we'll see about the impact of El Nino, La Nina, El Nino Madoki, Indian Ocean Dipole and monsoon winds on tropical cyclones. In my previous videos I've explained about El Nino and related concepts. Along with that I've explained about tropical cyclones, the favorable conditions for formation of tropical cyclones. So they form the basic concepts for understanding this particular concept. So I strongly suggest you to watch my previous videos on El Nino as well as tropical cyclones before watching this particular video. So in this video we'll see questions like why there is greater cyclone formation in Bay of Bengal compared to in Arabian Sea. Along with that we'll see why there is no cyclone formation during southwest monsoon months. First let us look at basic concepts. So I've explained in detail about all these concepts in my previous video. So this is just a quick recap. During El Nino months we have warmer waters in the eastern Pacific. This is bad for fishing in the region. And in the western Pacific, we have comparatively cooler waters. And during La Nina years, we have intensification of normal conditions where we have greater upwelling in the eastern Pacific, which is associated with cooler waters in the eastern Pacific. So this is a rich fishing ground during La Nina conditions. Whereas the western Pacific has very warm waters and this is good for rainfall, formation of thunderstorms in the Indonesian and Northern Australian regions. And other concept is El Nino Madoki, where we have cooler waters in both eastern and western Pacific. So cooler waters in eastern Pacific is good for fishing and cooler waters in western Pacific is bad for formation of thunderstorms. Whereas in the central Pacific, there is accumulation of warm water and this is good for the formation of convectional rainfall. And during La Nina Madoki we have exact opposite of El Nino Madoki. We have warmer waters in western and eastern Pacifics. So in the eastern Pacific it is bad for fishing, whereas in the western Pacific it is good for the region as it brings lot of convectional rainfall. And in the central Pacific we can see it is associated with cooler waters, so here it suppresses the formation of convectional rainfall. So before studying about the impact of El Nino and other concepts, so first we need to know about the conditions favorable for tropical cyclones. I've explained in detail in my previous video, but this is just a quick recap because this is a very important concept. So for a cyclone to form, we need a layer of warm water which extends for about 60 to 70 meters in depth and its temperature should be well above 26 degrees Celsius. So to be exact, the temperature of warm water layer should be more than 26.6 degrees Celsius. So below this the cyclone formation is suppressed, above this the cyclone formation becomes intense. So we need to have a thick layer of 60 to 70 meters. Again, this is very important. If only the surface is at higher temperature and if the lower layers is not at equally higher temperatures, even in such cases there is no cyclone formation. So we need to have a constantly 50 to 70 meters of warm water layer in the topper layers. And Coriolis force is a very important factor. So between 5 degrees north and south, we don't have cyclone formation. That is, the cyclone formation is very rare or completely absent. This is because of lesser Coriolis force. So beyond 5 degrees north and south, we have significant Coriolis force. So it aids formation of cyclones. So low level disturbances are nothing but thunderstorms, which are the ones which give rise to birth of cyclones, and they can be localized or created in the region where the cyclone formation starts, or they can be coming from the neighboring regions. For example, the remnants of typhoons from the western Pacific reach the Bay of Bengal, creating thunderstorms in the Bay of Bengal. So the lower level disturbances are very important. They are nothing but individual thunderstorms which combine to give rise to a greater cyclonic vortex. Cyclonic vortex is nothing but spiraling wind movement at a very great speed. And upper level disturbance is very important. We know that when there is convergence in the upper layers, it is associated with divergence in the lower layers, and this is bad for cyclone formation as divergence is associated with clear skies and there is no cloud formation. Whereas in the other case, when there is divergence in the upper layers and convergence, it is associated with convergence in the lower layers, and this is good for formation of cyclones. So this particular condition is called as upper air disturbance, and this is very important for formation of cyclones. And wind shear, coming to wind shear, we need the wind shear needs to be very, very low. So wind shear is nothing but the differences in velocities of winds flowing at the surface and the upper layers. We know that if the wind movement in this at the surface is from west to east, in such a case we have exact opposite direction of winds in the topper layers of the troposphere, where we have winds flowing from east to west. So here we have winds flowing in opposite directions in surface and upper layers, and this particular differences in wind velocities is called as wind shear, and this wind shear needs to be very, very low for the formation of cyclones. So while studying about why there is no cyclone formation during southwest monsoons, this particular point becomes very, very important. Again, high humidity is associated with warm ocean waters, so humidity needs to be well above 50 to 60% of air. So now let us study each condition. So during normal conditions, we have rising limbs of Wachasell. So rising limbs of Wachasell in the western Pacific is good for formation of cumulonimbus clouds, and also we have very warm waters in the western Pacific. As a result, we have good amount of rainfall as well as typhoon formation in the western Pacific region. So this particular region sees a very good typhoon formation. And in the eastern Pacific, we have falling limbs of Wachasell. Here we have falling limbs. As a result, here we have subsidence. And subsidence is very bad for formation of cyclones. Along with that, we have upwelling of cold water. As a result, this particular region has intense cold water. And this is also not favorable for formation of hurricanes in this particular region. And in the western Atlantic, we have piling up of warm waters in this particular zone. And also we have rising limb of the Wachasell. And this is good for formation of cyclones, because this kind of convection cells are very essential in creating cyclones, because lot of thunderstorms or low level disturbances combine to form cyclones. So it is good for formation of cyclones in the western Atlantic, and lot of disturbances which are produced in the eastern Atlantic move towards the western Atlantic, and here they get strong and move towards the coast of USA. Along with that, we have the cyclone formation in Bay of Bengal, which is very strong in during normal conditions. This is because minute disturbances or remnants of typhoons which are formed in the western Pacific move towards the Bay of Bengal, and here these minute disturbances creates or initiate cyclone formation, and these cyclones move towards Indian coast. So the cyclone formation in Bay of Bengal is intensified during normal years, whereas in the Arabian Sea, we have near the equator, we have divergence, and divergence is bad for cyclone formation. So we have very negligible cyclone formation in Arabian Sea during normal condition. So here we can say it is bad for cyclone formation in Arabian Sea. Normal conditions are bad, whereas in Bay of Bengal it is good, and in the western Pacific it is good. In central Pacific, again we have colder waters, so it is bad. In eastern Pacific, we have cooler waters, this is also bad. In western Atlantic, we have very warm and converging air movement. As a result, this is very good for cyclone formation. So remember this particular figure. So this is the cyclone formation in Indian Ocean during normal conditions. We can see this is the year 2013, the map of year 2013. We can see this particular cyclone, very strong cyclone called a cyclone Felin, which hit the coast of Orissa, causing a lot of destruction in the coast. This was a category 4 cyclone whose winds were close to 200 kilometers per hour. So we can see there are too many cyclones which were created in the Bay of Bengal, whereas in the Arabian Sea, the cyclone formation is negligible. This is during normal conditions. So what happens during El Nino years? We know that during El Nino years, we have convection cells or low pressure systems occurring in the eastern and central Pacific, whereas high pressure cells at the western Pacific. And low pressure at the Horn of Africa, and we have high pressure in the western Atlantic. So here again, we can, based on these rising and falling limbs, we can come to the conclusion of cyclone formation. During El Nino year, typhoon formation in the Pacific is intensified. That is, we have warmer waters in the central Pacific. As a result, typhoons form at very great intensities in this region, that is in the central Pacific. Whereas we have descending limbs of Wachasell. As a result, in the western Pacific, the typhoon formation is totally suppressed. So during El Nino years, that is in particularly the year 2015, saw very strong typhoons. This is because of typhoons which are coming from the Central Pacific and not because of formation in Western Pacific. So this particular year, we see typhoons which are moving from central towards the Philippine region, and then they move in this direction. So in normal years, usually they form very close to Philippines and they trace this particular path. Whereas in the El Nino months, they form in the Central Pacific and from there they move towards Philippines, and then this is how they trace their paths. So the typhoon formation that is hitting this particular region is because of formation of typhoons in the Central Pacific and not because of typhoon formation in the Western Pacific. In the Eastern Pacific, we have warmer waters. This is good for formation of hurricanes in this particular region. For example, in this year, there was Category 5 hurricane called as Hurricane Patricia, which was a very high intensity hurricane with winds reaching about 280 kilometers per hour. Whereas in the Western Atlantic, because of subsidence, the hurricane formation is suppressed. So we didn't see any significant hurricane formation in this year, that is 2015. So there is no in the Bay of Bengal, because of suppressed typhoon formation in the Western Pacific, the disturbances or remnants entering the Bay of Bengal are low. As a result, the cyclone formation in Bay of Bengal is comparatively lower. Whereas in the Arabian Sea, because of this convectional cycle, the cyclone formation in Arabian Sea intensifies because of convection of air in this particular region. So if you take an overall picture, in Arabian Sea, we have greater number of cyclones than normal. In Bay of Bengal, the cyclone formation is suppressed. In the Western Pacific, it is suppressed. In the Central Pacific, we have greater number of very strong typhoons. In the Eastern Pacific, we have hurricanes which are of very high intensity. And in Western Atlantic, the hurricane formation is suppressed. So this is during El Nino condition. This is the map of 2015. So we can see very negligible cyclone formation in Bay of Bengal, whereas we have few intense cyclones which are formed in Arabian Sea. For example, cyclone Chapala formed during the October ending days, hit the coast of Arabian Peninsula, creating a lot of disastrous effects in this particular region. Whereas we can see in the Bay of Bengal, there is no significant cyclone formation. And El Nino Modoki is a condition where we have cooler waters in both Eastern and Western Pacific and warm waters in the Central Pacific. So if you look at the convection cycle, that is Walker cell, we can see in the Central Pacific, we have very good convection, very similar to El Nino, but the convection which was happening, minor one, which was happening in the Eastern Pacific is totally suppressed. So there is absence of this particular convection in this particular region, upliftment of air is absent. So Eastern Pacific sees cold waters. So there is no cyclone formation or intense cyclone formation in the Eastern Pacific, whereas in the Central Pacific, the typhoon formation is very strong. And it is quite similar to El Nino conditions, except the cyclone formation in the Eastern Pacific. So during El Nino Modoki 2, we have good amount of cyclones in Arabian Sea and bad cyclone formation in Bay of Bengal and bad cyclone formation in Western Pacific and good very intense cyclone formation in Central Pacific and very bad cyclone formation in Eastern Pacific. And also bad cyclone formation in the Western Atlantic. And the La Nina condition is the exact opposite, intensification of normal conditions. So in normal condition, we have Walker cell, where the winds at the surface blow from east to west. As a result, there is piling up of water in the Western regions or Western Pacific region. During La Nina conditions, this particular cell becomes very strong. As a result, the piling up of water in the Western regions become very intense. So we have great pool of water in the Western Pacific. This creates very intense typhoons in the Western Pacific. So this particular year sees very intense typhoon formation in the Western Pacific, which adversely affects the regions of Philippines and surrounding regions. And the cyclone formation in South China Sea in particular is very strong. During normal years, South China Sea, that is this particular region, sees very low typhoon formation. Whereas during La Nina period, the typhoon formation in South China Sea is very, very intense, along with the typhoon formation in Western Pacific region. And we can see, because of subsidence and cooler waters, both Eastern and Central Pacific Sea, no cyclone formation or very low cyclone formation. Whereas the intensification of convection cells in the Western Atlantic creates good hurricane season for this particular region. So we have good hurricane formation in western Atlantic. Again, in Bay of Bengal, lot of low-level disturbances penetrate into this region, so we have good formation of cyclones in Bay of Bengal as well. And in the Arabian Sea, the cyclone formation is suppressed because of falling limbs of Walker cell. So this is all about the influence of El Nino and related concepts on cyclone formation. And now let us look at why there are very few tropical cyclones during southwest monsoon season. So the southwest monsoon season is characterized by greater wind shear. So we have seen that wind shear is bad for the formation of cyclones, and we know that during monsoon months, that is from June to August, we have intense southwest monsoon winds, that is winds that are blowing from masculine high towards equator, and then they shift towards their direction towards east, that is they are called westerlies in this particular zone, that is they move from southwest to northeast. So these winds bring good amount of rainfall for India, and these winds start from June to end, become very big in the ending months of September or in the middle of September. So till from June to September, the wind shear is greater. As a result, the monsoon winds suppress the formation of tropical cyclones in both Bay of Bengal as well as Arabian Sea. Along with that, there are specific other factors which influence cyclone formation. That is the location of intertropical convergence zone. So intertropical convergence zone is also known as monsoon trough, and this plays a very important role in cyclone formation. First, let us look at how intertropical convergence zone migrates from region to region based on seasons. So we can see during February, the intertropical convergence zone is somewhere here, that is it is moving towards the upper layers because of apparent movement of sun towards the Tropic of Cancer. So if you see, this is particularly June month, so we have intertropical convergence zone on the Tibetan Plateau. So we have significant monsoon winds blowing from masculine high towards the Tibetan Plateau in this particular season, in this particular month. And here the wind shear is high, and this doesn't facilitate formation of tropical cyclones. Along with that, the tropical intertropical convergence zone is on land, and when it's on land, it doesn't create any cyclones. So again, there is no cyclone formation because of two reasons. One is because of monsoon winds, as well as the presence of intertropical convergence zone on the continental regions. So in the intertropical convergence zone, we have convergence of winds. So this convergence of winds is created with intense upliftment, and when this intense upliftment is present, there are formation of thunderstorms. And thunderstorms, when they combine, when too many thunderstorms combine, they give rise to cyclones. So when this particular intertropical convergence zone is on land, the thunderstorm formation is suppressed because of less moisture available, and hence there is no cyclone formation. If you consider this with the times of September and October, we can see the intertropical convergence zone has migrated to the regions of Bay of Bengal, that is Central Bay of Bengal. And here the conditions are very ideal for formation of tropical cyclones. This is because the maximum temperatures in Bay of Bengal occur somewhere around August to September months. So even in the middle of October, the temperatures are very, very high. So the first condition of 50 to 70 meter layer of warm waters pre-exist. So this is very important for tropical cyclone formation. And we have a lot of thunderstorms which are occurring in this particular region because of intertropical convergence zone. And again, this aids formation of cyclones. So we see cyclone formation in October and ending of September to ending of October. So this is the very good month for formation of cyclones. So if you see, there are two factors. One is migration of intertropical convergence zone and the wind shear, which play a very important role in determining the formation of southwest monsoons, the tropical cyclones in this particular part of year. Next, why there are fewer cyclones over the Arabian Sea compared to Bay of Bengal. So usually the ratio is 4:1, that is when there are 4 cyclones in Bay of Bengal, there is only 1 cyclone in Arabian Sea. This is during normal conditions. Whereas in certain other conditions like El Nino and other times, usually this thing might change. But during normal conditions, usually the Bay of Bengal sees a great amount of cyclone formation compared to Arabian Sea. If you see why this occurs, we know that during normal conditions, we have minor disturbances which are migrating towards Bay of Bengal, and this is conducive for formation of tropical cyclones. Along with that, there are other factors like evaporation. This is a very, very important factor, because we know that there is warm fresh waters flowing from Ganges and other mighty rivers like Godavari into Bay of Bengal. As a result, this particular layer of Bay of Bengal sees fresh warm water where the salinity is low, and is this particular water layer forms a very thick layer about 50 to 70 meters, and this thick layer is very important for formation of tropical cyclones. And when we have a thick layer, the vertical mixing should be negligible, because when there is vertical mixing, the warmer waters falls, there is mixing of warmer and colder waters. As a result, of mixing, the temperature of this particular water falls, and that it is not conducive for cyclone formation. But in Bay of Bengal, due to lot of fresh water incoming, there is this thick layer which is formed, and it remains stable for a very long time. Whereas in Arabian Sea, that is in this particular part of the ocean, Arabian Sea, we have greater salinity of oceans. As a result, when there is evaporation, there is a lot of moisture which is lost, and this particular region becomes dense with the presence of salts because of evaporation. And this salty water is very dense, and it sinks to the bottom layers, and the bottom cool water replaces this particular layer. And this kind of situation creates vertical mixing. As a result, the column of water, which is about 50 to 70 meters thick, and it is very warm, this column of water is disturbed. As a result of vertical mixing, this particular region, the temperature of the upper layers decreases, and this is not conducive for cyclone formation. So evaporation is very important. So higher salinity leads to greater vertical mixing in the Arabian Sea. As a result, the cyclone formation here is suppressed. Whereas in the Bay of Bengal, the vertical mixing is very low because of fresh water layer which is at the top, and due to lesser vertical mixing, we don't have we have very constant warm water layers. As a result, this is good for cyclone formation. And again, we have seen about monsoon winds. The wind shear during the Arabian Sea sees greater intensity of monsoon winds. As a result, here the wind shear is higher, and in August month, usually the monsoon winds in Bay of Bengal are negligible, and also the northeast monsoons have not yet strengthened. As a result, this particular part of the year is good for formation of cyclones in Bay of Bengal. Along with that, we have seen how water cell influences the formation of cyclones in Bay of Bengal region. And along with that, there is one more concept called as Indian Ocean Dipole. During a positive Indian Ocean Dipole, we have warmer waters in the Arabian Sea and comparatively cooler waters in the Bay of Bengal. So cooler waters in Bay of Bengal is not good for formation of cyclones, is not so conducive for formation of cyclones in Bay of Bengal region. Whereas warmer waters is also not good for formation of tropical cyclones in Arabian Sea, because warmer water creates intense southwest monsoon winds. As a result, there is greater wind shear. As a result, the cyclone formation is suppressed in both Bay of Bengal as well as Arabian Sea. But we have very good monsoons when there is positive ocean dipole, that is when we have warmer waters in the Arabian Sea. And during other case, we have negative Indian Ocean Dipole, where we have warmer waters in the Bay of Bengal and cooler waters in the Arabian Sea. And it is bad for both cyclone formation as well as monsoon winds in the Arabian Sea, and hence India sees lesser rainfall. Whereas the Bay of Bengal, we have warmer waters. As a result, the cyclone formation in Bay of Bengal is intensified. So during negative Indian Ocean Dipole, we have good cyclone formation in Bay of Bengal and bad cyclone formation in Arabian Sea. So next, small question, it might be important for prelims. Which sector of the cyclone experiences strongest winds? So when a cyclone is moving in a particular direction, let us say it is moving in this particular direction, and this particular direction is called as north, and to its right it is east, and to its left it is west, and again this direction is south. So when a cyclone is moving from in this direction, in such a, in that particular condition, we have winds in this particular sector, that is the eastern sector, which are very, very strong. So the eastern sector sees very strong winds. This is because the cyclone is moving in this direction, and winds are also moving in this direction, that is winds flow in this direction. As a result, there is addition of velocity because of both movement of cyclone as well as winds. Hence, the wind velocity will be stronger in this particular zone. Whereas in the western zone, that is this particular zone, we have winds which are blowing in this direction, that is opposite direction, whereas cyclone moving in this direction. So velocities have cancelled in this particular condition. As a result, the wind velocity is very low in this western sector. So the wind velocity is maximum in the eastern sector and minimum in the western sector. When we say a specific region of a cyclone, then the wind velocity is very strong in the eye region, that is the maximum winds are observed in the region surrounding the eye. It is called as eye wall region. So when we consider sector, usually eastern sector is the strong, sees the very high velocity winds. So this is all about the video on effect of El Nino and other conditions on the formation of tropical cyclones. And thanks for watching. Don't forget to subscribe.